And okay, so good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this radio resource management course lecture on ambient backscatter communications for 6G meshing type communications. So this is a lecture basically based on the research of done in my research group, and also some prepared this kind of tutorial and also in some conferences, so I'm reusing some of the material here. Please ask questions if something is unclear. I try to keep this on relatively general level. There are a few equations here and there, but try not to be alarmed by them. Let's see if I manage to get the next slide. Okay, so the outline for our talk is this line, like this. So first I will give some brief motivation for this ambient backscatter type of communications, for machine type communications, then discuss about the basic principle and some of the applications. Then discuss on the modulation methods used in backscatter and ambient backscatter devices, about the propagation if in case of backscatter. Then there is some specific problem in ambient backscatter communications, which is this direct path interference, so we'll discuss that more. Also, another specific issue is the coexistence. So ambient backscatter communications is a system that is using a spectrum of another existing system. So then there are some coexistence issues. I will discuss about the fundamental performance limits in terms of capacity. Then discuss about the applications of this backscatter communications for 6G machine type communications. And then something even beyond 6G. Okay, so let's start from the motivation part. So if you look at the IoT devices these days, one of the limiting factors is the availability of, or the lifetime of the battery. So there are of course already many wireless system, sensor systems that sort of promise over 10 years of battery lifetime. But actually that battery lifetime is very much dependent on the deployment. So how far from the base station that device is, how often it is transmitting data and whatsoever. So then, and in this devices, in IoT devices, we don't have screen. So in mobile device, we have screen, and that is probably the most power hungry part, but along with the transceiver. But in IoT devices, it's actually just the transceiver part that is the consuming much of the power. So somehow the aim of this ambient backscatter communications is to transmit without actually having a transceiver. Well, of course we have some components of the modem, but basically what we can get rid of is this voltage controlled oscillators, we can get off power amplifiers and whatnot. So we come to that. Another motivation is that actually there is already quite a lot of signals in the air. So do we really need more signals? So could we somehow reuse some of the existing signals? One way of reusing these existing things is to do energy harvesting. So that we try to harvest the energy that is in the air. So, but the amount of energy that actually can be obtained in this way is relatively small. So there are, this is just a table of different kind of power amplifier, power harvesters, but RF power harvesting is quite challenging. So you need to have relatively strong signals. So this harvest and sensitivity is typically something like between -30 to -20, -25 maybe, something like that dBm. So it's really, really high power. And also the harvester efficiencies tend to be relatively low. So then if you are relying on her harvester, then it would be nice to consume as little as possible. And this is just then how much is actually power is consumed by these different kind of devices. So if you see here, kind of a power levels where available is some maybe tens or hundreds of microwatts. Then if you look at some long-range radios like NB-IoT, that consumes maybe 500 milliwatts. So it's way too much compared to what the energy harvester can support. So there are only some short range radios, like maybe BLE, or even that is 20 milliwatts. So that like the harvesting sort of possible energy source for the device. Well, actually, the last device category here is the RFID, and that's that has a power consumption on the ballpark that we actually can maybe get from the harvester. And those that RFIDs are the kind of devices that is used in backscatter communication. So that's the most widely used backscatter communication system. So if you look at the basic principles, so backscatter communications actually, so backscattering as a phenomena has been used in radars. So you send a signal, that signal gets scattered from the object, so airplane for instance, and then you use it, scattered signal, to detect whether there is a object there or not. And this backscatter communications, I mean, it's very really old, so it was for backscatter phenomena like radars, they are really old, so it was made during the Second World War. But then it has been actually used for communication applications also for a relatively long time. So these RFID systems, radio frequency identification systems, they are actually quite common. And the nice thing about these backscatter devices is that they don't really use this much power than the active transmitter. So there can be like factor of 1,000 reduction in power consumption. And also this cost compared to the actual active modems is like, because of there are less components and possibly also printed components. So the cost is also like 10 to 100 times less. And this is illustrating the operation principle of backscatter communication system. So in RFID case, we have this reader device. It has, in this case, it has two antennas, but it could be just one antenna and some sort of full duplex device. So it is generating unmodulated carrier. That carrier goes to this modulated backscatter system, which is then modulating this signal. And this modulated signal is then scattered back to the reader. So this S here is just the carrier, and then X1 is the information added by this backscatter device. And then the title of the lecture said ambient backscatter. So ambient backscatter is somehow related also to radar. It's related to passive radar. So in passive radar, you don't actually actively generate this signal to interrogate the object, but rather that you use some existing signal in the air. So these passive radar systems also is almost as old as radar. So during the Second World War, I think both the UK and Germans were using passive radar. So with radio FM or AM transmissions, they were detecting airplanes. But that has been used for communications only very recently. So in 2013, there was a seminal paper from University of Washington where they proposed the concept of ambient backscatter communications. And the idea of ambient backscatter communications is that instead of unmodulated carrier, you actually have now modulated signal. So there is a, for instance, a TV transmission or radio transmission. And you modulate this already once modulated signal and try to then decode your signal from the receiver. So the first ambient backscatter communication system was really proposed for TV, but then after that it has been actually proposed to used for many different applications. And the basic principle of the original ambient backscatter communications was that and we have doing just on-off keying with this backscatter device. So it's an antenna which we, if we have a short circuit, it is reflecting the signal, and if the signal switch is open, then it's basically going to our load. So then it's absorbing the signal. And then we can basically detect this backscatter signal communications by looking at the envelope of this signal that is scattered from the backscatter antenna. But the one challenge here in ambient backscatter system is that we have actually not just this scattered path, but we have this direct path component. And this direct path component is orders of magnitude stronger than the scattered one. So that is the direct path interference problem, which we will be discussing later on. But there are receiver structures and methods to deal with this direct path component. But it basically, we need some sort of method for nulling this interference. Otherwise, the signal to interference plus noise ratio for the the scattered signal is really low. We can have different kind of systems for using ambient or backscatter communications. So I will, during this lecture, actually use ambient backscatters, kind of a general term that includes both those systems which have unmodulated carriers as well as those which have got modulated carriers. So I use it as a general name. So the basic RFID system is this first one here. So we have the RFID reader, and that is sending a signal to this device here, which is then controlling the switch to do this on-off keying modulation. And then you have the receiver, which is co-located in with the transmitter, that is decoding this message. So this kind of system is said to be monostatic. So the transmitter and receiver are in the same place. Then we could have bistatic backscatter scenarios where we have transmitter and receiver antenna separated in space. And when we have this kind of setup, then we already need to deal with this direct path interference component. Of course, here it is just a carrier, so it's easy to cope with. Whereas if we go to this ambient backscatter communications case, you have here, for instance, the TV transmitter. It's sending a signal, and that is now modulated by this tag. Then there is this direct path interference component. And then we have maybe some legacy receiver. So this signal that is modulated by this backscatter device might be on the same band as the original signal, which means that there could be some impact on the legacy receiver. And this is something that we will discuss as well. So then this legacy receiver is just trying to decode the original message sent by the ambient source. We can also modify this cat if you would have some sort of more clever receiver that would try to decode both messages and do joint decoding. Also in monostatic case, we can do this that we have some sort of modified, for instance, a modified Wi-Fi access point that is sending a Wi-Fi message to this device here, then this tag is modulating that Wi-Fi signal and scattering it back to the access point. So these are the kind of different kind of scenarios on how to deploy this backscatter communications in wireless systems. So let's look at the state of art. So most of you are actually familiar with RFID. Maybe you haven't really thought about it, but I mean, if you go to a library and loan a book, that book actually has this RFID tag and based on which, or some of the books in some libraries at least have these RFID tags there. So there's a tag reader to detect which book you are loaning. Some of them are using just some optical codes. Or in warehouses, there's this kind of logistics applications where these parcels have these RFID tags, and then you just, there's a reader antenna which is interrogating, and then you read which boxes are in this line here. Or then these toll stations. There is no toll stations used in Finland, but in some countries there are. I think the closest one is in Sweden, so in Stockholm. So there you put in your car window, you put an RFID tag, and then there's a toll station has this reader device that is then reading the tag from the car. So then the system knows that you have paid the toll. Or another application, if you participate in the running competition. So for instance, there has in our campus, we have the Espoo Rantamarathon. So when you have these marathon runs, there is actually the timing is based on the RFID chip that is printed on the number tag of the runners. And that is commonly used application of RFID. So RFID is actually used a lot, and this is kind of a well-known and tested technology. But then if you look at this kind of ambient backscatter or type of things, then there are, or go beyond just tag reading. So RFID tag, basically it's just sending an identification, but you can actually start building communication systems with the same principle just by changing the protocols, so that instead of just sending an ID, you send something else. And one thing is that you could, for instance, send voice. So there's an example of a battery-free cell phone that was developed in University of Washington. And it is actually a first-generation cell phone because it's actually directly doing analog modulation of the voice. The same group also have a battery-free HD video streaming, so there's a camera that is operating without battery. These devices have a relatively short range, but anyway, it's interesting possibility for new kind of applications. Another application where this kind of simple passive tag type of devices, which are contain sensors, are useful is in medical applications. Because putting a battery in that kind of device, which is implanted is dangerous because battery has dangerous chemicals. So getting rid of the battery and using backscattering is something that is actually used in practice. Also one interesting application was to have kind of a passive devices which are completely mechanically powered. So then there's a mechanical movement like that causes this tag to be modulated. So it's like this old pianos that were self-playing. So the same principle is used here, that some mechanical movement, like you open this bottle, so then this movement of opening the cap then actually modulates the tag and so forth. And these backscattering devices have been proposed to be used in various different type of sensing applications, and in quite many of the sensing applications, actually, it is using some sort of analog modulation where the antenna reflection coefficient is somehow directly changed by the measured quantity. So, for instance, there's a humidity measurement, so this humidity is directly affecting the reflection coefficient in this application. But you could also put some sort of microcontroller and use this backscattering to have a generic sensor device, and then you have machine type communications. Also, some people have been proposing to use these backscatter devices for improving security. So sort of change the environment so that you can try to, based on this this kind of multipath profile, be able to distinguish between the transmissions of legitimate users from some active attackers. This is maybe a somewhat niche or specific type of application. Okay, but let's look at the modulation operation in more detail. So in backscattering, the idea is that we have this antenna in the device, and somehow we modulate or change the reflection coefficient of this device. So there's antenna, so the antenna impedance, so we could change the antenna characteristics, or then we can, more common is that we change the antenna load impedance somehow based on the information that is transmitted. And simple examples would be that we could, for instance, do this amplitude or on-off keying by changing this load so that whether it reflects more or less. Or if we can also change this load impedance to cause phase shift to happen. But also frequency shifting is possible, and I will show actually how it can be done. So here are examples of simple backscatter devices. So we have, this device has one, this is the load, and then there's this switch, which is basically a diode. So if the diode is conducting, then we have short circuit and there's a reflection. And if it's not, then the signal that comes to this antenna is dissipated as heat from at this load impedance here. But the simplest way to do phase shifting is just that we have this antenna and then we have transmission line. And with the, how long is this transmission line, then the more there is a phase shift. And all kind of different kind of modulation schemes can be built using backscatter communication. So this is kind of a generic phase shift keying type of device, which is able to do 8 PSK. But so also this frequency modulations can be done, and amplitude modulations. But with amplitude modulation, there is one restriction that if it's a passive device, it cannot amplify the signal. So you can only make it weaker by attenuating it. So one way of, and we will see this in the coexistence case more, one way of dealing or doing modulation is to do a frequency shifting. And in a frequency shifting case, we have, there are two ways of doing that frequency shifting. This is a single sideband, and the other one is double sideband. So double sideband is easier to generate, but this sideband effect is not that nice. So it will actually cause iridescent channel interference with this kind of device. But the single sideband mixer is a simple device that has two diodes, this load and the transmission line. And this transmission line is selected so that with the given frequency of the signal, you get 90 degree phase shift. And then this bias voltage for this diodes is selected so that the one is cosine and the other one is sin, and the frequency is the frequency shift that we want to make. So then this is somewhat, there's some font problem. So this should have been this angle phi. So I need to check what goes wrong with the fonts. So, okay, then there are some analyses here that if this phase frequency of the signal that comes here is not exactly matched to this, so that it doesn't have exactly 90 degree phase shift, because if I do this device, I can only with one particular carrier frequency get this 90 degrees phase shift, and if I change the carrier frequency just even a little bit, then the phase shift will be something else. So in the ideal case of just illuminating this tag with the carrier frequency case, we have actually just that the output of this device will be that carrier shifted by this frequency delta F. And if it's not exactly matched, then depending on how big is this frequency deviation, so then we will actually have some out of band interference power. So if it's very small change, then this power that goes out of band is extremely small. The 0.1 means is then you already start to have really wideband signal. So it means that the bandwidth of the system is 10% of the carrier frequency. So in that case, we would have something like 40 dBs out of band emissions. So that means that we cause interference to the neighboring bands. And then since we are now possible, it was possible to do frequency shifting, we can also do frequency shifting that is changing in time and generate chirps. And that is something that is also being proposed in literature. So in chirp, you have a sinusoidal signal with frequency changing in time. And then you can, for instance, delay this chirp pulse to get different symbols. So for instance, in LoRa system, that is using this chirp spread spectrum to to transmit their those signals from the active radios. But then people have been proposing to use something similar with the backscatter devices. And one of these examples that are using chirps is this net scatter system. Then we saw this example of battery-free camera. And that was actually using analog pulse width modulation. So there's image sensors that is then basically photo detectors. So it's a camera grid, and then that camera information is modulated using pulse width modulation. And that pulse width modulation is now driving this impedance of this tag to the on-off keying. So if you look at the nice features of analog modulation is that if you plug in this case of the voice communications, where you had them, that is actually, I think there, no, here's an example, my slides are not in order. So here's an example of an analog voice modulation. So this is actually something, this part of this device is something very similar to what was done in analog telephony systems. So basically the voice signal is directly controlling the amplitude changes in this tag. So then you have directly amplitude modulation of the voice signal. So it is really like this AM radio type of system or analog telephone system. And then other examples of analog modulation for sensor system is that you can have some sort of device that is directly doing the modulation of like the frequency shift of this device is corresponds to the accelerometer outputs of the sensor, and there are another example of like that. So this is on a RFID band, so that the reflection coefficient actually becomes directly a function of this the output of this MEMS switch sensor. So if you look at now this analog modulations, so the nice thing is that then you don't need to actually have a microcontroller in your device. So you can make it really, really low power. But the not so nice thing is that it requires relatively high signal to noise ratio to operate, and then the signal is not encrypted and there is no error correction. But on the other hand, this is the minimum latency. So this ultra low latency communications in a sense that you are not introducing any other delays to the signal than just this simple electronics. So this is the lowest that you can go with the latency, in a sense. But if you have a lot of devices, then it's better to use some sort of analog, communications that you can separate the ongoing transmissions. And also, maybe in many applications, you need security. So that is very difficult to realize in it using the analog modulation schemes. Then just using, compared to these passive devices, one can also use some sort of active device and a little bit amplify this signal that comes to the antenna to improve it. And another thing that we can do is that if the size is not an issue, then we can make, instead of a scattering effect, we can use reflections, which would be much more beneficial in terms of range. Okay, so reflection amplifier basically is a device where this switching diode is actually amplifying the signal somehow. So there's an tunneling diodes in those devices. Then those actually have, you can actually amplify the signal. So that whatever comes in, then the output signal gets amplified by this device. So it's kind of about having a negative resistance in the operation values. So and typically this power that comes into this backscatter device is pretty weak. So using this sort of amplification can be really useful in extending the range, because the if you are in this ballpark of having, say, minus 72 dBs dBm input signal, then with certain kind of diodes, for instance, here you can get even 40 or 30 dBs gain to this signal. So it's the same as if you would have received minus 42 dBm. So these kind of gains that you get in this low power area can be pretty high. But if you're already in this high power region, then using this kind of tunneling diode thing doesn't help at all. But this is actually quite promising method for building long range backscatter devices, because the diodes, although it's amplifying the signal, its power consumption is relatively small still compared to the active RF power amplifiers. Just keep this. Apologize, I seem to have this, some of the slides in slightly strange order. In backscatter communications, the scattering effect is that, let me see if I can draw. So, scattering is that we have this antenna here, there's some wave that comes in, and then it actually gets, it's going to all the possible directions. Whereas if you have a reflector, like a mirror, then it's the signal is more directive. So this is reflection. And the reflections have been used in communication systems to enhance the communications in, especially in mountainous areas. So this is a picture of this kind of reflective panel that is used to boost the and direct the TV signal. So this is actually kind of a commercial product. But if this is not controllable, but then People have been proposing to use controllable reflectors as well. Kind of a reflector that is really brightly visible and is used in radars is corner reflections, corner reflectors. So this kind of a device here. So these are typically put in a small boats, for instance, to make them more visible in the radar. But one can also tweak those devices so that you put there actually voltage variable components that you can control. So to actually can control whether this is reflecting or not. So this kind of backscatter communications have been proposed in the radar setup that you would have this boat with the corner reflector being able to send some identification information through the radar to the ship that is trying to detect the small boat. So if you would use this kind of reflection effects, then that is also a way to get better range. And this kind of reflection type of systems have been recently proposed to be used to improve the propagation conditions in indoors. So there's actually nowadays quite a lot of research ongoing in large intelligent reflection surfaces, or large intelligent surfaces. So these are basically, you can think these devices as kind of an array of this kind of backscatter type of devices that you can control. So the aggregate effect is that you can control how the signal reflects from this array. But of course, you could also modulate the signal, modulate the way that this thing is modulated. So if there would be some sensor driving, like for instance, in if this is a system used in to enhance the communications in a room, then you could have, for instance, a humidity sensor and then whatever temperature sensor, and somehow embed that information to this phase shift that is done by this array, so that you would actually also use this for communications. Okay. So let's look at the backscatter communications from the propagation perspective. So the propagation is quite different than in the traditional case where you have just the transmitter and receiver, but here you have the transmitter, the tag, and the receiver. So there are two links involved. This is just showing how the link budget goes. There are a couple of things to look at here. One is that, I mean, in normal direct link here, if you just look at this link, then the sort of free space attenuation would be dependent on the square of the amplitude and the square of the distance. But now we have these two links, so this is essentially whatever is the link gain in this link multiplied whatever is it in this link. So it will become a function of fourth power of the wavelength, which means that if we go to very high frequencies, this term starts to dominate, so that making this received power really, really small, unless we are using a lot of power, or if we somehow manage to use really big antenna arrays to mitigate this effect. But this lambda to the power of 4 is quite a challenge for going to higher frequencies. But if you go to low frequencies like FM, then of course, I mean, then in, this is like in FM band, and this is on the order of magnitude of meters. So then it doesn't matter so much. Okay, there are many terms. So there are the distances, so distance in the first link or distance in the second link, or if it's monostatic, it is the distance in the first link to the power of 4. Then we have various fading margin related things. We might have terms related to the potential polarization mismatches on the antennas, and this modulator in the backscatter devices is causing some losses and whatnot. And just to show some measurement results on the TV band. So then we had isotropic antennas. our modulator at the tag had a 6 dB loss. So this is in an anechoic chamber in the Otakari 5. So we have a transmitter, receiver, and a backscatter device, and the location of the backscatter device was varied. So we have this kind of U-shaped. So the theory says that the propagation curve is like this kind of U-shaped shape. So if we are close to, if this backscatter device is close to transmitter or close to the receiver, then we have a high received signal strength. And the worst position possible is just in the middle. So this is the in bistatic case. In monostatic case, it is, looks more like the traditional case, except you have more steep drop because it's fourth power of the wavelength and fourth power of the distance. Okay, the same kind of type of measurement done in a corridor. Here is really visible this U shape because we had longer distances. So here it was up to something like 3.7 meters, but here is we're up to 8 meter distance. Okay, so this is the red one is what the theory says, and the blue one what is measured, but that those variations are because we have the reflections from the walls, we have people moving around, so this kind of shadowing effects. But there is relatively good match, and also outdoors, very good match. So here we are measuring even longer distances. So this kind of received power levels would be still feasible for certain type of applications if you use some error correction coding and whatnot. So I think in LoRa, the minimum possible received power level is minus 140 or something like that. So this is like even 30 dBs above that. So much longer distances could be achieved. In fact, actually, people have demonstrated LoRa backscatter where you have had hundreds of or a couple of hundred meters of backscatter distance. And this bistatic case is even kilometer in one link if the other link was like 1 meter. So in scattering case, just to summarize, we have the kind of a first link gain multiplied the other link gain. If you would have reflections, then it's different. It's like one link gain with just some distance. And in practical regions, this would be much better than scattering, but it is difficult to get this reflection effects because it would require really large structures and then how to control those reflective structures so that it's doing the modulation is non-trivial. One more thing that is different than in single link is fading. So we would have fading in the first link and fading in the second link, or in this monostatic case, we see some sort of fading in the first link when it goes, and then the same, maybe even the same fading when it's coming back. So whether there is independence between these two fading terms here depends on the deployment. So this just shows the quite big difference in fade margin that we need to have. So if you have constant amplitude signal, so like the backscatter system, and then we have Nagagami M where M is 6, like just corresponding to kind of a direct path, a line of sight communications, we would have this kind of setup that maybe, okay, with the outage, 1% outage, we need a 8 dB fade margin. But what happens in ambient backscatter case is that also the ambient source signal has varying phase and amplitude. So actually for the receiver of the backscatter device, it looks exactly the same as relay fading. So now suddenly it becomes kind of a relay Nagagami channel. And to obtain the same outage level, we would need like more than 20 dB fade margin. So, okay, this is the case when the ambient source signal was Gaussian, so which is roughly the case of an OFDM signal. So it depends on what the ambient source is. If it's like FM signal, then maybe we are closer to this constant amplitude case, but if it's OFDM type of signal, we are somewhere here, and if it's something else, we are probably in between. So fading is one big challenge in ambient backscatter systems, because there's unknown phase and amplitude of the ambient source signal that can be varying very, very fast. So it's compared to normal fading system where we have like the fading is changing in a, typically we use block fading channels. So we say that the channel stays more or less the same for some duration of time and then changes slowly. Now here, actually, it is rapidly changing, so it can change like each symbol of my backscatter device using, it will see independent fading. So that is really extreme fast fading. So let's look at the problem of direct path interference. By the way, at this stage, would there be any questions? Just use this chat to indicate if you want to ask something. Or do you want to have a break, or should I continue directly? Unless somebody insists of having break, I suggest that we have it this as a one go okay, at least we have one vote for yes. So I will continue. So let's look at the direct path interference at the receiver, the problem. So here's my transmitter, here's receiver, and here's the backscatter device. And there's a distance D0 between the transmitter and receiver, and then distance is D1 to this tag, and D2 from this tag to here. So at least D1 plus D2 is greater than or equal to D0. So if you look at then the ratio of the signal to noise ratio, so the signal to noise ratio 0 is the direct path SINR, and then we have the SINR in the backscattered path. That will actually be function of the wavelength squared, and then some antenna parameters, and then this sort of relative difference in the squared distances. And here, once again, actually this wavelength thing is a really important factor. So this lambda over 4 pi squared, this term tends to be really small. So even if this distance is term would be like close to one, then this is the dominating term. And here are some plots with the different distances in FM band, where the wavelength was 3 meters, assuming that D1 plus D2 is equal to D0. In FM band, the distance that we can have from one large radio transmitter can be up to 10 or even tens of kilometers. So here's a kilometer, 10 kilometer, here's 100 kilometers, so this is 50 kilometer point here. So we see that the power difference between the direct and reflected path can be really, really big. So in this setup, the worst case was like minus 70 dB difference in the signal strength. So that means that if I'm somehow would be able to get rid of this direct path interference using digital receiver, I would need to have this dynamic range in my the analog to digital converter that has 70 dBs dynamic range. So one bit would be 6 dB, so that would be 10 bits more than what I otherwise would need. So maybe I need a 20 bits analog to digital converter, which can be quite costly, and it's actually quite difficult to build. So one reason to get rid of this direct path component is to somehow solve this dynamic range problem. And to solve the dynamic range problem, then we should get rid of this direct path interference somehow in analog domain. Ah, there's somebody asking for a short 5 minutes break. So let me see if I can somehow stop the recording for a short while. Pause. Okay, so this direct path interference is one issue is to somehow make the receiver design possible with a reasonable amount of bits. So that if you need a lot of bits, then one thing is to start oversampling. So that, but that means more costly receiver. So if you just look at, if you would not compensate for the direct path interference, just treat it as an interference. So we have what the signal, we have this direct path component, and then we have this backscattered one, which is modulated by the backscatter signal, and then the X0, which is the unknown ambient signal sent by this transmitter here. And we regroup that this would be the kind of a fading term, plus this is our signal, and then this would be the interference. And look at what would be the result, assuming that the ambient source signal would be just a Gaussian signal for the sake of simplicity. And then we are doing a kind of a on-off keying with hypothesis testing whether the signal is power is kind of just this direct path component, or there is a kind of a this backscatter component present. So if you would have, this is the signal to noise ratio of the ambient, and this is the signal to ratio, signal to noise ratio of the backscatter device, and this is the ambient direct path component. So if you have just a sinusoidal case, you would have this bit error rate curve like this. And then when we have a Gaussian ambient, we would have something like this. So now if you want to have this bit error rate of say 1% in with the Gaussian ambient, we would, this signal to noise ratio in the backscatter path should be like 30 dBs above that of the direct path. But if you look at this plots that we had for how it was, it is always actually below, or maybe in some extremely small distances it could be larger. So that would not be really feasible. So we need to do something to cancel out the direct path, and we can do that in several different ways. We can do it in time domain, frequency domain, spatial domain, or then by signal processing. So time domain is just we have use really really long symbols. So even if the signal to noise ratio per sample is extremely small, but then if we average over long enough time, we can get some gains and be able to decode. But this leads to extremely low data rates. Then in frequency domain, what we can do is, yes, if this was the spectrum of the ambient signal, if you have doing this double sideband modulation in the tag, then we will basically, we could shift this scattered signal component a little bit so that in this guard band of the original signal, we would see the backscattered components. And this is just an example where this was tested, this kind of idea that, okay, here we have this the simple one switch, one diode, and backscatter modulator, and this was the direct path in FM signal in this case, and then it was shifted to onto the adjacent band simply by just generating the sinusoidal signal to feed this diode digitally from the FPGA device that was here. And then we can do frequency shift keying. But in theory, you could do it cycling through phase shifters, but more practical thing is to use this single sideband frequency mixer that we saw before. So in this case, we would move the spectrum of the scattered signal to this, for instance, to this one card band or the other one, and you have do FSK. So this would be more robust in terms of receiver performance than trying to do it in this double sideband where you just try to detect on-off keying on those. So FSK is always more robust, because in FSK you don't need to know the noise level, but here we are comparing to the noise level, so having the right threshold is tricky. Okay, then there is yet another frequency domain approach, but yeah, skip this one. Then in spatial domain, if you have multiples of antennas, we can actually use the differences in the antennas. So this is actually one of the original papers of ambient backscatter. So where this direct path component was solved by using two antennas and then actually looking at the amplitude thresholds between the antennas to get rid of the impact of the direct path component. But the basic idea, if you have multiples of antennas, is to do kind of a null steering. So we have this ambient source coming from one direction. I'm assuming that there isn't that many sort of the angular spread of this ambient signal would be relatively small. So we put null to the direction of the ambient signal, and then we try to steer the beam towards the backscatter tank. So this is the radiation pattern if you would happen to have 8 antenna receiver, so we could put the null here to this direction. If I just have 2 antennas, then I mean, I can mechanically with 2 antennas by this, if I just sum down signals from these 2 antennas, then there's the phase shift here actually depends on the rotation. So from which direction the signal is coming. So like whether it comes, the signal is. So if you have signal coming like this, or signal coming like this. So from if I have this sort of signal, then we have a kind of a null of this array pointing to this direction. So this, if I my ambient source signal is kind of in a fixed position, like some FM transmission tower or TV transmission tower, I could just take my 2 antenna array and steer it in a way that I have this null pointing to the ambient source. And then depending from which direction the backscatter device is coming from, then I will get, depending on how well I manage to null, but here in this simple setup with not so ideal antennas, I got something like 30 dBs compared to this, if I have this kind of a orthogonal directions for the signals. And more generally is that if I have a lot of antennas, then what I could do is have this kind of a, I do analog domain to this angle of arrival estimation of the strongest signal, for instance. And then I null it. So if I go back to the previous one, no, this one. So I put a null in analog domain to this signal and then try to point the beam to this direction. And then I make another beamformer where I put beam to this direction and try to make the nulls to or make the signals quite weak to other directions. So in, now I get in this beam I get an estimate of the ambient signal S, whereas from here I get the estimate for this X. So now having an estimate for this S means that now I'm able to track the unknown phase of the ambient signal and use coherent receiver for that. So that's the idea. And that is actually something very similar to what is used in passive radar systems. In passive radar systems, you typically have here a passive radar. So you have this whatever TV transmitter. You have a reference receiver pointing to that. And then you have your radar antenna pointing to this whatever target there is. But the idea here is also to get an estimate of this unknown signal S. So here is just a in passive radars, typically two separate antennas is used, whereas here we can do it with one array. But in principle, we could use exactly the same setup as in passive radar. But if we have this kind of case where we would have service area that is completely opposite to the direction where the signal is coming from. One more way of getting rid of this direct path components is to use polarization differences. So there's, if you look at typically what we have in many communication systems is we have using linear polarization, so signal is kind of propagating in one dimensions, but then we can also use circular polarized antennas or elliptical polarized antennas. If I use linear polarized antenna at the transmitter and circular at the receiver, then I lose 3 dBs in the signals. So they are not really that well separated. Of course, I use linear vertical and linear horizontal. They are in principle orthogonal, but what happens is that you have all kind of reflections in the environment, so then you actually end up having components that are no longer just vertically polarized at the receiver, but you also have the horizontal polarized components and so on. So those directly doesn't help, but the way to do this kind of canceling is that if I have a linearly polarized device, then I would have so ambient source is linearly polarized, then I would have an ambient backscatter device where I somehow change the polarization or so that the signal that comes in maybe is a linear polarized, and then here I use this polarized antenna. So the polarized antennas we can have left side, left hand side, or right hand side polarized. So here is like if you use left hand side polarizations, then what we have here in the coming to this antenna we have the direct path component. And that is sort of present both in the left and right hand side things, just attenuated by these 3 dBs because this is a circularly polarized antenna. And then we have only in this left hand side antenna we have the backscatter signal present. So when we subtract these two, we get rid of this component completely. And then what is left is just this backscatter signal. So this is a setup that can be used to use polarizations. So it's kind of a multi-antenna setup, but it is more compact, and there is two antennas in one in some sense. And then if we happen to have a lot of bits available and at the receiver, so that we don't have to care about this doing any processing in analog domain, we could just use sequential interference cancelling. And the backscatter signal component typically is so small that we could still decode the ambient signal source, and then once we have done that, we can cancel it out and then get the signal of the ambient signal of the backscatter device. Okay. So now we have discussed the basic principles of how these devices work, and how this one problem of direct path interference can be managed. But then there's a question, do our backscatter device actually cause interference to the ambient system that it's sharing, because it's sharing the same spectrum? Of course, if we are doing this frequency shifting and we shift the backscatter signal to some other bands, then it's completely interference free. But in some other cases, maybe there is some interference effects. So what is exactly the effect actually depends on how we do the modulation. So if backscatter device has very long symbols, then it looks like a passive receiver or a passive repeater or just additional multipath component. So then basically the receiver of the legacy system, the ambient source system, that is able to track the channel variations caused by the backscatter, and it's just additional multipath component. If the backscatter device is using really fast transmission, so very short symbol duration, then it looks like this kind of a fast moving Doppler type of component, that as if there would have been some fast moving device moving close to the receiver. So just an example, if we consider the digital TV and it's using OFDM, then there are certain, this is the OFDM frame, there's time and frequency, and there are certain symbols that are the pilots that are used for estimating the channel. And now the critical thing is that, like, how fast is the channel varying, whether we can actually estimate the channel accurately or not. So if you look at just in general this kind of a simplistic model of the digital TV receiver, we have this signal is kind of a weighted sum of the multipath components. So CK is, if there's a transmitter, then here's our receiver. So there are multipath components. So maybe there's C0, and then there's some scattered components, C1 and so forth. So they are just the multipath components. And what fraction of this multipath component is kind of a useful power at the receiver, it depends on how large is this delay in this path compared to the cut time of the used in this OFDM system. So if it's within the cut time, so then OFDM takes care of the multipath components, and then it's like fully useful. And then if it's really large delays, then it goes outside this whatever window this channel estimator has, and it cannot be, none of that power is useful. So it all translates to interference. And well, we can then look at there some conditions on this desired to undesirable ratio for TV reception with 39 dB. So there are the direct path component, and if I just take one multipath component, this CK or C1 in this case. So some fraction V of that power is useful, and then the rest is causing interference in the sense that it cannot be tracked by the channel estimator. So if you look at this ratio, this setup, it actually, if you have the receiver, have this interference source in somewhere in this elliptic area, so if you have put it in some area which is relatively close to the transmitter, this actually have also some height. So that this is the H2 is the actually the antenna height of the of this guy here. So in the dominating case is that we have the transmitter somewhere quite close by, but they're just separated by maybe the antenna height. So we see that, and this is just normalized in terms of wavelength. And this is the original where the transmitter of the TV is. So this protection actually happens. Protection condition is met only if this interference source would be really close to this receiver. And in fixed reception, if you think of a building, you have the directed antennas here somewhere on the roof. And if you had a backscatter device somewhere here, there's no way to cause so much interference that it would appear there somewhere. So it's basically quite the interference effects of single tags is very small. We also have analyzed the densities that one can have if you start to put a lot of those devices. And okay, then at, of course, at some point, if you are really having a lot of those devices, then you might have some effects. But this condition is not met. I mean, this we might be in this reception area if you would have if you are would be indoor and we have this kind of antenna on top of the television set, and then we have the backscatter in the same room. So there, we might actually end up having causing interference to the TV reception. But that is still a question of what is this. How fast is this backscatter device symbol changing compared to the OFDM symbol? So this is the worst case, so that all of the signal component is interference. But if you have, if you select this backscatter symbol duration to be say larger than the TV OFDM symbol duration, then actually very small fraction of this power would be causing interference. In some conditions, it can be actually. And looking at this one, then this you can see that actually, in certain conditions, this can even improve the SINR. So if this W is close to one, then we actually are increasing the desirable signal power. So we are acting as a passive relay to, or one more multipath component that the OFDM receiver can track. Another example of coexistence that is then is done in the ISM band. There is this concept called hitchhike. So there's a Wi-Fi system. The Wi-Fi is actually sending Wi-Fi packet, and then if this device is some is synchronized or detects the start of the Wi-Fi packet, it can make a phase shift. And actually, there is a way to make a phase shift on a Wi-Fi packet so that it, after phase shift, it, the code word is changed from one to another. So this is, means that this could be received just using standard Wi-Fi reception, except that this direct path component would be so strong that where we have this code zero, that if you don't do anything, then this we wouldn't be able to decode this information sent by this backscatter device. And now there's this phase shift difference somehow harmful for the reception as well. So what we can do is to do this frequency shifting. So in this hitchhike, they were doing this double sideband thing because they use a very low voltage oscillator and it was easy to do. But more elegant thing would be to use a single sideband thing. But basically, it's so that they used in one band there is the Wi-Fi signal, and then the backscattered Wi-Fi signal is in the neighboring band. And this is actually just the unnecessary component that could be mirror frequency that better design would actually filter out. So here the sort of coexistence is done in a way that we are orthogonalized in frequency. To use this system would require this access point. So we have the access point here. So it would send this whatever request to send type of message on both on this band. Let's call this F0 and this one, which is F1. So we would need to send this on both bands. And also maybe clear to send to ourselves so that to reserve the channel. And also probably we need to check that both channels are free. So that makes the access point operation a bit complicated. Okay, so let's look at just the fundamental limits. What can we achieve if you use this kind of ambient backscatter system? So now we have considered the system. We have MIMO link. So without the backscatter communications, it would have this channel gain complex matrix G0. And now we are adding this backscatter device, which has K antennas here. So there's this additional multipath components that are added there. And those multipath components have this phase, and this is the backscatter signal. And this X0 is the ambient source signal. So this guy is sending X0. And at the receiver, we try to get decode both X0 and X1, X1, X2, and XK. So if you look at the capacity equations, it's actually there is a so capacity would be something like and there is the so I can rewrite this whole thing as is Y is there's G0, G1, blah blah blah, GK. There's X0, X1, X0, like this. X0, X1, and up to X0 times XK. Plus Z. So let's call this H. And this is some X. So in general, this capacity equation says that this is H, some Q, H, where this Q is the covariance matrix of this guy. It's the X times X permission. So this is the correlation structure of the input signal. So there will be some correlations now. So this is in normal case, if I have a massive MIMO system, if I don't know anything about the channel, I would select this Q to be identity matrix. But now what we have is actually Q will be constituted of multiples of these identity matrices. And this is log det determinant. Okay, so what we have here when we look at this matrix, we will have this kind of a cross terms But if you have take a massive MIMO limit, then in massive MIMO limit, actually this when we have this as random matrices, cross terms vanish, and what are left is actually kind of the terms that are just relate to one of these kind of paths. So it's more clear when we look at the capacity equations in the massive MIMO limit. We will have what is the capacity of the MIMO system that would have kind of a, alone in the rich scattering environment, and then we have additional capacity. So this is the total capacity that is available for both for the backscatter and the direct path system. And so there are so-called keyholes. So in MIMO setup, if you would have a keyhole channel, the keyhole channel is that we have a lot of antennas here at the transmitter, but then maybe we have just a small opening like and then we have the receiver. So there are only all these paths go through this keyhole. This is a keyhole. So what we see here is that direct path as or this kind of rich scattering case of without the backscattering, and its backscatter antenna is a keyhole, and that adds to this capacity. One more thing is about this capacity, that what is the actual capacity available for these backscatter devices? If you look at literature, quite many people ignore the fact that we have a strict power constraint. So it's not the normal Shannon capacity formula that we can use because we have peak power constraints. So we can use, to calculate the capacity, we would need to use something more complicated like this Wiener polar phase coding capacity, but that's a minor detail. In what is left is, or the actual result is, there are different operation points in terms of signal to noise ratio. So if we have, would have the MIMO link alone, we would be in this point D. And then if you put this tags to operate as just passive relays, so we add multipath components, we could get this capacity from D to C. So now these relays are only helping us and not transmitting any information on their own. And if you add these tags and let them transmit there at the same time, then we will get this little bit smaller capacity B. But this is the capacity difference is very small because the signal components from the tags are relatively small. So this would be is the point where we are first decoding the strong direct path signal, and then and the tags are just causing and after that the tags are decoded, and then with time sharing we can get this line here. We can say that some of the time they are just helping the tags are just helping the direct path, and sometimes they are just causing interference. So there are conditions where we actually, by having these backscatter devices in the environment, we are generating more capacity. So it's an interesting way of sharing spectrum, that you are actually using this power that is already in the air, you're using the same spectrum, and we are generating more capacity. So theoretically, it's quite interesting. In practice, of course, it's slightly challenging to obtain this kind of gain. So quite often, the direct path interference is just solved by shifting the backscatter signal to another band, which means that we don't have this kind of capacity gain in a sense that we are just using the existing power, but not really sharing the spectrum. Okay. So let's then look at how we could use it in this 6G setup. So in 6G, we can have just that space station is sending unmodulated carrier and trying to read the tag, or maybe the base station is sending some sort of downlink signal, and then this back tag is modulating and scattering that back. or we can use some sort of D2D that the base station is sending, illuminating this tag, and the tag is then sending signal to this receiver here. Or then we could have some active device transmitting to the base station, and that power illuminating the tags, and then the base station trying to receive. So this kind of setups work well if this distance is very small. But then it's interesting to see, can we actually do this? So to analyze this, we did some ray tracing simulations. So this is downtown Helsinki, and these are actual base station sites of certain operator in downtown Helsinki. And we look at certain locations. Some of them are indoor and some of them are outdoors. And put the backscatter devices there and start analyzing whether we get coverage or not. Assuming some 3GPP antenna models and looking at frequencies that are below 900 megahertz. So 900 is a GSM band, 700 is an LTE band. 500 is currently used for TV broadcasts. Also 200 is currently not really used that much for anything. Or then there are some specific proprietary systems there. So if those frequencies could be reformed, then what kind of performance we could get. And we assume that this transmitter would use something like LoRa type of waveform. So looking at what is the LoRa receiver sensitivity. So this is for one case I think this was for 700 megahertz. This is the received signal power pictures here. This is the limit for LoRa receiver. There are two curves here, so depending on what do we assume for the building penetration loss. So it's the kind of a new type of passive houses that have very thick wall or older houses, so that actually has a big difference. Okay, well, the outage is somewhere between 20 to 50%, so it's pretty high. But if you look at then where the outage is, so these blue dots are outdoors, so there's actually reasonably good outdoor coverage. The bad coverage is indoors, and especially indoors, if you go to ground floor, it's really bad. Maybe second floor, not so great, but when we go high up, then we start to have coverage. And so this is just the coverage plots in there. So where are we having coverage holes? But maybe this is more interesting. So there's different frequencies and overall outage and outage probability outdoors or indoors. So with 700, we could already have reasonable outdoor coverage, but really bad indoor coverage. But if we go to 500, then we have really good outdoor coverage and still not very good indoor coverage. But going down to 200 or below, then we start to have already indoor coverage. So in principle, it is possible if we can get new spectrum in the lower frequencies to utilize this kind of a backscatter communications directly in a cellular setting. Okay, then the final topic. So we have seen that this backscatter communications is somehow applying radar technology. So RFID, you could say that it's the application of a normal radar for communications. Then the ambient backscatter was the use of passive radar for communications. So then what about the quantum radar? So quantum radar is something that has been proposed where you generate an entangled pair of photons, and you send one of them in the air, and the other one you store, and you then whatever comes back from this radar to the receiver, then we do joint detection where we use the received photon and the one which we store. What happens here in the air is that the entanglement that we had originally gets lost, because this is a really noisy and lossy environment, especially now since we are talking about microwave. but there are still non-classical correlations between this, what came back and what was generated in the and stored at this radar here. And we can use those correlations to improve the sensitivity of the radar beyond what is possible with classical setups. There are other effects also that in certain conditions also the radar cross-section of this kind of plane becomes more higher in certain conditions for the quantum radar than for the classical one. So one could then think of a communication system that would utilize the entanglement as a resource. And the nice thing here would be that the communicating device, the backscatter device, could be still the simple backscatter tag. So here is this thing here would be just normal, just this antenna and the switch type of thing. So it's the same device still. But then we would have this device that is generating the entangled microwave photons. The challenge of building this kind of setup is that there are already available, but they require the use of superconductive microwave circuitry, which means that the operation temperature of this type of thing is in some millikelvin temperature level, whereas here we have 300 Kelvin. So this cooled down a lot. And the main challenge is this, when the photon and the noise comes to the antenna, we need to attenuate and cool this signal a lot so that we keep this temperature down. Otherwise, we would fry out this circuitry here. So that makes it quite challenging in practice. But in theory, at least you could have this set up, or you can build the whole system currently in a fridge and get it working. But that, of course, has a little limited practical usage. But with this kind of system, what one can try to do is one can build quantum protocols that are covered so that you cannot really eavesdrop. You can use it for sharing the key, or quantum key distribution, or then covered communications. Once you have the key, you actually are communicating in a way that there is no way for the eavesdropper to detect even that the communications is ongoing. And the other thing is that you can really minimize the power that you put on the air. So you can reduce or get the receiver sensitivity gain of 6 dB over classical systems. So you can basically, this is the, like, get the ultimate minimum amount of photons that you need to illuminate some device in order to read it. So maybe in some medical applications that would be really useful. But this kind of systems, the quantum illumination gain, that is the quantum illumination is the technique to get this 6 dB gain. There are some limits on that okay, with PPSK, so phase shift keying, we really do get this one. So there's this is the PPSK, so binary phase shift keying with this quantum receiver. But then if we, so this is the ideal quantum receiver, but then the more practical quantum receiver actually is 3 dB worse, so you get only 3 dB gain over the, so this is the best known receiver structure. So you get 3 dB gain compared to system where you don't use this entanglement as well, but you still are using quantum system to illuminate. But if you try to use it for higher order modulations like UPSK, then ideally we could only get this 3 dB, and in practice we get nothing. So this basically, there are some limitations on on this setup that can be done. But it's interesting that to look at the kind of this, this is like the ultimate limits of the system that one can get in, for instance, in terms of security, that or really minimizing the radiated power, but not only the radiated power, because this is not a power minimization scheme, that to cool down this thing actually consumes a lot of power. Okay, maybe it starts to be time to conclude. So ambient backscatter communication is actually quite interesting and promising communication scheme, because it can share the spectrum with other systems without, in certain cases, even without causing any interference, and actually some cases even improving the reliability of the other system. And it allows us to use really low power and relatively simple transmitters. But then there are these challenges in the design, especially the receiver design is more challenging in the ambient backscatter case than in a normal receiver case. And with this quantum, then it starts to be possible even to go beyond the limits of the classical system. And here also, I mean, this backscattering is the key in a sense that we need to generate this entanglement pair and do the joint measurement. So this quantum illumination cannot be utilized in a, like in a communication link, but it can only be utilized in a backscatter setup. Okay, so this concludes the lecture for today. So now I try to stop recording.